Hello everyone, it's Oliver Harper here and I'm back with a new commentary. And today my good friend Tim Partridge is joining me to discuss Ghostbusters.
Hello.
You may remember Tim from some of my older commentaries on Darkman, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 and Ninja Turtles. The commentary is an audio podcast, not a video, but you can sync up the commentary with your own copy of the film by putting the timestamp to zero and pressing play now. Now, the film starts with the Columbia Pictures logo with the classic Elmer Bernstein score, which is used as the instrument from the 1920s.
Hans Martineau.
Yeah, which he also used again, I think, a year or two later in The Black Cauldron.
And Spies Like Us.
That's right.
And also, at the beginning, the first sounds I think you hear are the DX7, which is the first MIDI synthesizer.
That's right.
And now we begin at the New York Public Library on that brilliant opening shot of the lion, which is really scary with the music swelling up.
Yeah.
And I think this is so clever because what people don't give it credit for is that it sets up the world and the grammar of the Ghostbusters universe. And I think first and foremost, it sets up a New York, a fictional New York that's not like the real New York, that doesn't have any steel and glass in it. Notice that none of the locations throughout the film have any steel and glass. It's all this kind of turn of the century brownstone.
That's right.
And the first person we see as well is the librarian, who's, you know, a much older person. And notice in the film it's designed so you don't see anyone under the age of 30 in it. You don't see any children in the film either, too. And there's a bleakness to that. It kind of makes you feel mortality, I think. But I think there are other reasons for
there is some children near the end during the sort of celebration, isn't there, when the Ghostbusters win, but there's no focus on children at all.
There are no characters.
No.
But I think that I think there's another reason for that, and I think that this film isn't really about ghosts. This isn't a ghost-busting film. In fact, this film ceases to become a ghost-busting film two-thirds of the way in. And it's funny because there's a franchise called Ghostbusters, and there's a sequel, and there's a cartoon show, and it's all about. But the film isn't about that. I think this is really a black comedy about going into business and having to conform. And a lot of, if you read a lot of material on Ghostbusters, a lot of people say, oh, it's a Reagan era sort of pro-capitalist, pro-business film. And I don't think that necessarily is the case. I think it's kind of against that. But anyway, with this opening, we're setting up this, as I say, the fictional New York. And if you actually go to New York, if you go to these locations, they're all scattered around across the city. They're not all condensed. But the film, because it's so amazingly, brilliantly designed and directed, it gives you the idea that it's almost like a giant haunted house. You know, everything is kind of is turn of the century and old and gothic. And, you know, with statues, and obviously we transition here now to another statue as well. It's like the New York of this film is wall-to-wall statues. And of course, they're setting up the dog for later.
That's right.
But, and now, immediately, you know, we get to meet Peter Venkman. And you can see that he's completely abusing and taking advantage of his position in academia. Actually, also interestingly enough, the first sequence we've seen at the library is another kind of, you know, institute of academia. You know,
yeah,
so
yeah.
It's interesting.
But it also introduces his also kind of obsession with trying to get after women. You know, sets up that he's, you know, a little bit pervy, but he's not that. The film kind of plays down his, obviously because it's PG territory, but he's
taking advantage of life, kind of living off the state,
yeah,
you
yeah.
Know, he works in academia, but he's abusing the system, and they get caught out eventually, and that's actually been likened by a lot of film critics have kind of compared that to other films that Ivan Reitman has made, such as Stripes, obviously, and Meatballs, and even Harold Ramis films like Animal House, where it's going against authority.
Oh, and Caddyshack as well. You've got rebellious kind of teenagers and things like that.
Yeah, and it's kind of
dealing with adults.
Yeah, adolescence, and I think Ivan Reitman's even said himself, you know, it's kind of a commentary on the baby boomer generation, and what I like is that they're abusing this position, and they've never really. I mean, later on, you'll see when they go into the library, there's no sense of management at all in the lives of Peter and Ray and Egon. They kind of just do what they do. And the thing is, Peter doesn't have a place in this, you know, and later on.
Well, he's basically kind of the odd one out of the pair, out of the trio. He's because they're obviously very much enjoying that student life and haven't really experienced the outside world. And Peter kind of implies that he has, even though he's within that world as well. But he seems more aware of what's going on around him.
He needs to know enough to get by, doesn't he? And he's really a person who is a good communicator, which is why he's been able to manipulate it.
Well, definitely, because he becomes the mouthpiece of the Ghostbusters. He's the publicity guy, the manager, essentially.
But he's, as we can see here, he's very easily distracted from his job, and he doesn't really have a function at this university, even though he's a doctor,
He lacks focus, and he gets that focus near the end to save Dana.
But the fact it's been allowed to happen, that it's been going on for so long too, and he's just been skimming his way through. And now, of course, we meet Ray, and he's much more enthused as a character. He also is a scientist.
Oh yeah,
Egon is a scientist.
Yeah, because he comes across as just as intelligent as Egon, but he's far more kind of childish in his attitude, and he's overly enthusiastic about everything.
But even
he's a big kid.
But even now, during this scene, it kind of almost feels like Peter's almost protecting a client. It's sort of setting up things for later, and it is quite adolescent, isn't it?
But you can't help be kind of sucked into Ray's enthusiasm for everything. I think that's why Peter's kind of tagged along.
Yeah, they work as a good kind of triangle.
Oh, definitely.
I think. And now they go to the library, and I think this is again really good at setting things up, because you're establishing Peter as the leader, I think, in a business venture. I mean, we'll get to that in a second. He's hilarious, isn't he, Bill Murray? I mean,
it's his deadpan humour. It works so well within this film. Because as a kid, I didn't really take notice of many of the gags. I was all about the visuals and the action bits. And it's more as I got older and older, into my teenage years and into an adult, every time you revisit the film, there's always another gag you found.
Yeah. But even here, there's no management to it. There's no, discipline.
The library itself?
Yeah, they're just, you've got the scientists have just turned up and they're just kind of there. There's nobody communicating with.
But also you've got the manager of the library as well, who kind of, I presume it's the manager who.
But it's all kind of been done slapdash, isn't it? Can we come over? Can we have a look? Whatever. But at this point, Peter's kind of taking the lead. We're seeing him being the front of house of the business for the first time.
Yeah.
Of what will become later a business venture.
We could imply that Egon and Ray are kind of linked to the library, or were students before, so they've got this kind of communication with them, so they can get in and do what they want.
Yeah. But, I mean, there's a blackness to it as well, because, I mean, the other thing, I mean, we'll get there later with the ghosts, but if you notice in the film, the ghosts are portrayed entirely as malevolent and negative.
Yeah.
You never see any bereavement, or there's no loved ones get resurrected during this. They're just all purely evil.
No one's related to anything they see. Someone said, like, for example, you could have, in the montage sequence, they could have had someone, hey, my grandfather's come back to haunt me, whatever.
Yeah, but they shy away from it completely. Yeah.
There's no connection. I mean, for people listening who've played the video game, there is a connection about the old lady in the library, her connection to this place. But in the film, there's none of that's implied. It just seems like it's just an old patron or whatever who resides there.
Yeah. But, I mean, they could have gone that route, and especially, I mean, later on, you've got the bit where...
But that ties into what you were saying about earlier on about it not being about ghosts.
It's about business.
It's
about setting a business up and getting caught up in that. The other thing, too, with the rulemaking, the way it sets everything up, the PK meter here, it's just a really clever visual device, because it's so well designed. It's visual, and you've got the sound of it too, but as soon as those aerials go up that they're
in
trouble.
Ghost,
But they've not said that. They've not said when this goes up, there's no exposition.
No, it doesn't, no.
You just get it. It's a really clever unspoken thing. It's really, really good production design, really good direction. And of course, slime, which has become almost like a part of the Ghostbusters branding.
That's right. And for the sequel, they changed the colour for it to be more like the cartoon. The toys they were selling of slime, you got that purple slime you could get.
It's interesting because as I say, setting up this kind of this grammar of the Ghostbusters universe, I think is something that people don't pick up on, I don't think, when the film is discussed and the rules of it, because it's a black comedy, you know.
Oh yeah, it goes in sync with the Ivan Reitman's previous work and Harold Ramis's as well.
And it's incredibly, you know, there is a mean-spirited feeling to the whole film that's carried on more so into the sequel, when they actually overtly say, you know, we're miserable in New York, we're grumpy in New York.
Oh yeah.
And you know, that's
because the second one really pushes that Victorian kind of architecture.
Well, not just that, but the people, you know.
Yeah, of course, yeah. I'm saying in terms of, that, as you mentioned earlier, about the sort of this how the city is represented.
Yeah. But the kind of the gruff New York vibe, the kind of that sort of stereotype of people being kind of, you know, gruff, that manner. They link it into this, and now we're going to see. Actually, you notice there's a lighting change. You notice from the spirit.
You were saying, because Tim hadn't seen the Blu-ray before, and when he watched it again, well, for the first time, really, he didn't. Well, there's quite a lot of grain in the image. Now, you were kind of saying the film stock at the time.
Well, it was 1983, wasn't it, that it was filmed in. And, yeah, the light sensitivity wasn't as high as it would have been later on, probably for the film stock used on the sequel. Yeah. And they were shooting in anamorphic as well, which takes a lot more light. But anyway, that's less interesting than the ghost that we can see at the moment. And I was going to say, just with the first ghost that you see on screen, almost like Victorian print photography, kind of that kind of... It reminds me of the imagery that James Wan now uses in his films.
If you look at any kind of photographic evidence of ghosts from years ago, there's always something, a character looks like someone from a Victorian age.
Yeah.
And I think this is what the film's trying to do. And it's,
yeah.
And it does it successfully. And also, what you're saying with terms of its architecture and stuff. So it kind of feels like...
It's creating a fake haunted house.
Yeah.
Something that isn't a fake haunted house.
Yeah.
But that's the brilliance of it. And you never see anyone who is... I don't think you see anyone who's born or actually... active after what, 1920 in this film?
Wouldn't that...
They're all period ghosts.
That's right. I mean, as you were saying about the actors and stuff, I mean, that generally comes with doing the time. In the early 80s, most people were in their 30s who were stars or older. No one was really young as a star. Do you think?
But there's a huge divide between everybody who's living in the world and the dead. As we said, you know, you could have had somebody's, you know, I mean, it would be quite grim, but imagine somebody had their mum die a year ago and they, you know, they come, the Ghostbusters, they're then paid to then get rid of them, you know, an inconvenience.
Well, I was always baffled by the film, though, where we already know the kind of Egon's obviously very tech savvy, but the funding they get, which you see in a minute about... well, shortly after they get kicked out of the school. It's how they built the equipment. That is never revealed. And he's got a nuclear accelerator on their back and stuff. I think it's kind of the MacGuffin of it all. It's like you don't really... It's just a plot device to sort of get it moving. There's no explanation about how things are constructed.
It's interesting, too, that Venkman is so responsible when he's at the university, when he's working at the university, and he's aware of it too. He knows, he later discloses, doesn't he, in the prison, that he has, let's pretend I have no idea of how science works.
But he's got PhDs though. Do you think he's kind of cheated his way through it?
I've no idea, but you know, they're fully aware too that they've got these, they refer to them as what do they call them? Illegal nuclear...
Nuclear accelerators, that's what they're called.
Yeah. Unlicensed.
Unlicensed, yeah.
So they're in on it, you know. They're taking risks all the time. And it's clever how you've got, you know, your traditional dean telling the children off sequence now done with
Animal House kind of thing.
Harold Ramis. So it's interesting that you've got that now with grown adults. It's quite funny.
Do you think the directing styles has changed a lot for Ivan Reitman from the previous film he did into this one? I mean, do you think, because if I look at some of the other comedy films they've made, they're all a lot more rough around the edges.
It's interesting because there are a lot of, you know, there are a lot of master shots in this. You know, you're seeing like three people in shot at the same time. You see a lot of two shots.
Yeah. A lot of dialogue overlapping scenes, you know, which is a classic trait of a comedy.
But all that grammar, that kind of comedy filming, he always had it. I just think because it's shot in the anamorphic format and you've got a cinematographer of, you know, Laszlo Kovacs's
incredible DP
stature. It elevates it. It makes it something else. And the beautiful use of Steadicam that they have throughout this film too, I think, really brings it up.
I suppose, you know, given, because I think when Ivan Reitman had, you know, proposed this film to Columbia, they said, how much do you think it's going to cost? And he came up with a rough estimate of $30 million. They went, right, okay, here's the money. We want it next year on this date in like early June. So given that money, he's got $30 million. He's going to choose, you know, I want my favourite DP, I want this, I want that. You know, I've got the money, and to make it look like a big budget movie.
The other thing that I was going to say was too, I think certainly in that museum sequence with the ghost, I think Peter learns to delegate. He's learning to be a manager too. He's learning, like he says, he's told by, I think, Ray. Doesn't Ray say, Peter, go get the ghost at one point?
Well, no, well, because when they approach Zool, he goes, go get Ray. Pete Wakeman tells him to do it, so he's dictating, and Ray's got to do it.
Yeah, but much
but earlier on, he's like, well, we've got to talk to the ghost, and no one says anything, so Wakeman's like, oh, I'll do it then.
Yeah, yeah. From that point onwards, he learns that rule, so at that point he delegates, he tells people.
Yeah, because he knows the outcome of it all.
Yeah. You know? But it's showing himself as a business leader. I love the performance here of the real estate agent in the background. Whose eyes
just
and
grinning.
Performance. Well, her eyes, just her eyes. Amazing. Her disapproval. It's a caricature, you know, one note, one scene, but she just does so much with it. Great, great performance. And of course, this beautiful firehouse, which isn't the one in, you know, they filmed the exterior in Tribeca in New York, and the interior is filmed in
LA, isn't it? Yeah. Because they also used it again in Big Trouble in Little China.
Is that right?
That's right, yeah. That's where, is it Egg Shen?
Okay.
That's where he lives.
Again, look, this is a three shot, and you've got her at the end. There's no cutting to... I mean...
Imagine that in pan and scan. You probably wouldn't even see her.
And, of course, here we're introduced to that amazing matte painting of Spook Central, and with that, the introduction to Dana. And it's interesting with Dana's character, too, that she's from the arts world, isn't she? She's a classical musician.
She plays a cello, doesn't she?
Yeah.
I think so.
But what I quite like is that, I mean, you know, it's argued that now if this film had been made today, she'd be probably a lot more active as a character. It's just the way I think women in film were written at a certain time. Mm. But what I love is Sigourney. It's Sigourney Weaver playing it, so already she's, even though she on paper is a damsel in distress, you kind of get behind her. I think she's really brilliant as a character.
And for me, it's always interesting seeing her again because... everyone's familiar with her from Alien,
which
is, you know, very headstrong. But in this, she's far more in a vulnerable state and more kind of not playing this kind of leader, as it were, as she becomes in Aliens. But she, it's nice seeing her playing something more down to earth, I suppose.
Also, Rick Moranis as Lewis, and I love Lewis's character because
he's one of the best ones in it, one of the best characters.
Yeah, well, I think...
It becomes a key element to the film.
I think there's a theme... The film seems to kind of say that you have to either be cynically making a living or you're a dead inconvenience and there's nothing in between. And Bankman kind of gets something from that at the end. But I like the fact that he says things... You know, he's really overt with this because he's an accountant. He name drops all of his clients. He judges all of his clients.
He's very nosy person.
And he's keeping up with the Joneses all the time. You know, I love the way he says, specifies, would you like to come in for a mineral water?
Yeah.
Somehow elevate his
status.
He's
all about the details, isn't he?
Yeah. But he's also he's a gratuitous networker as well. I mean, that's the whole point of him having his party. It's for his clients. Well,
yeah, because by the end, as soon as he sees the Ghostbusters, he's like, who does your taxes? You
know? Yeah.
But, do you think it would have been interesting with John Candy in that role, or was it would have been miscast?
Because
he wanted to do a German accent, wouldn't he? Something like that. And
I don't know. I think because we're so used attached to Rick Moranis, I think it'd be difficult to hear, you know. But I think John Candy's an amazing comedian, so it could have worked completely. The other thing, the great directorial thing that Ivan Reitman does here, when he's in Dana's apartment, in all of the scenes actually, where she's by herself, he brings the sound down. And he takes the music almost down completely.
He does, takes it out. But then he slowly comes back in again.
Yeah, and he uses shock effects, you know, shock sounds here and there. But it makes the suspense really crawl. It's really
bit of foreshadowing
amazing.
Start, Marshmallow Man.
Yeah. Well, again, it's about business and branding. I mean, you've got... I mean, that's the other... I mean, the Stay Puft Stay Puffed is an imaginary brand, as you know. And you'd think from watching this film that it's something everyone recognised. When you see that monster at the end, it gets a huge laugh, but nobody's seen, you know, that's the only place you've seen it. And then you see it, you know, they're just tiny details here and there. I think there's a billboard later on the side of a building. Yeah. But, like, it's quite funny how it creates its complete own self-contained universe in that way. That could have been something else, couldn't it? It could have been, I don't know, it could have been another branded character.
No, yeah. Captain Crunch, whatever, you know.
This is absolutely terrifying.
Beautiful. Because this is... Cause Richard Edlund had just left ILM, set up his own company, which was in part funded by Columbia. Boss Films. And he... Because ILM did like to use a lot of the VistaVision. 55 millimeter?
65 millimeter.
Well, that's not VistaVision, though. VistaVision was slightly smaller.
I forget.
Because Boss Film wanted to use 65 instead.
Oh, yeah. No, sorry.
Gave it high resolution. So... sort of one up on ILM. So when you see these big plates, I just like the resolution is so good. But I always love this scene because when he tells him the price, his face is like stone cold. You know, Ray just is really bad with money because he's bought a car which is completely buggered, basically. Needs to be totally repaired.
But they're always running at a loss, aren't they? Always seem to be running at a loss throughout the film. There isn't, and again, this is why I don't think it's an anti-capitalist. It's not a pro-capitalist movie, because you never see them, you know, indulging in excess. They never, you know, they don't have massive disposable income. They always seem to be paying things off. They're kind of working just to exist, you know.
Oh yeah, yeah. Because as you're saying, you never see them enjoy their money. They're always continuously working without a day off. And Janine even complains she hasn't had a day off in like 2 weeks. The ghosts start coming out.
Annie Potts is wonderful. I think she's great. Really, really underrated in this role. She's kind of, well, her and Winston, they represent kind of the everyman too in business too. You know, they come and they do a day job, you know, and they go home at the end.
Yeah.
I also like the way that this is shot here, because they lay out the firehouse almost like a sitcom kind of thing. You know, it's open plan, and you've got all these different areas, and it allows you to set a different kind. They got a great shot before where Egon comes up from below the desk, and you know, they're playing with things.
I always love the second floor though, where they're kind of lounge and kitchen. I always love that area.
Yeah. And so Dana is the first customer of the Ghostbusters.
That's right.
Do we just see... again, here, it was just saying... You know,
someone pops up.
Yeah,
you know.
They make full use of this kind of open plan environment.
He's trying to, as soon as he speaks to Dana, he's in smooth mode, trying to charm her.
But he's also kind of weighing up, you know... I mentioned this before we actually recorded the commentary... It would be in the Ghostbusters' best interest to prolong, you know, Dana's case for as long as possible, because they would be making, if this was really, like, again, if this was a proper business venture and they were taking, and these are not responsible people, they've set them out.
Yeah.
As, you know, if their interest was really in really making money in a shameless way.
Yeah,
and taking advantage of customers, which I don't think the goal of the Ghostbusters is to do.
Yeah,
they would make sure that they never solved that case, because as soon as you know, as soon as they work out that the whole thing with Zool is the cause of all the ghosts in the city,
yeah,
that effectively puts them out of business.
Well, it's true, but there's no way they can essentially stop it, because Zool is all Gozo. It's getting more and more powerful. So if Dana was, you know, later on, which they've put her to sleep, essentially, you know, because she's going out of control, it's only till once the containment unit is destroyed, that's when its full power kicks in and she gets awoken again. But if that didn't get shut down, then yeah, it would have gone on for longer. But the containment unit would have been so packed up, like full of ghosts, they wouldn't be able to contain it.
Well,
so
the fact they set up that parameter as well, you know, with the Twinkie later on. But this sequence here with Peter taking the walkthrough around Dana's apartment as well, it becomes somewhat adolescent, doesn't it?
I always feel like Peter always... The professionalism in this sequence for him kind of dips heavily, because he becomes too fascinated with Dana. And you know, he's a little bit too forward, isn't he? In his attempts to kind of ask her out.
Well, he's kind of backward. He's almost like 10 years below his actual age, maybe 15 even.
Mm.
In work, he's just learning how to kind of be a business, how to be a professional.
Because he's not done this before. He hasn't even gone out and checked a house. So this is like, he's just being shown how to use the equipment and just see what happens, you know.
Yeah, but he's learning how to be a working professional. He's also learning how to be almost a fully functioning human being. He doesn't really have any empathy. I think that's what is kind of, you know, that's kind of what sets him up at the beginning as somebody who doesn't really have any.
He's very self-centered and driven by his ego.
And you get that at the moment, the beginning with the lady with the cards.
Yeah, oh yeah. But he's never really that successful. That's the problem. He's driven by his ego and self-determination, but he never really gets what he wants. Just continues and continues and just keeps hammering at it.
Yeah, but he's kind of, he's a big drifter.
Mm.
And she, Dana, becomes like a focus to him.
Yes.
So I actually think this first case, the Ghostbusters' first case, is also their undoing.
Mm.
This leads to the end of the Ghostbusters.
She's
the worst thing that could happen to the Ghostbusters.
Because you were saying when we were watching it the day before, it becomes a god-busting movie.
Much later. Act. I mean, we'll get to that. You know,
sure.
Much later. But
that's cans of Coke. They're huge in the 80s.
Yeah.
Ridiculous.
I also love, too, the way that the suspension's set up. You've seen all of this stuff before, and then it's getting diffused by Peter much later. They do that again with the painting, don't they, in Ghostbusters 2?
Yes, they do, yeah.
Pretty much. I think the chemistry is great between these. And again, I think Sigourney Weaver is an amazing actress.
Oh, yeah, she's always, you know, on top form in everything. Even though if the film's a bit rubbish, she's always really good in them.
Yeah.
But she's playing a character that is far more intelligent than Peter Venkman. You know, she's just as smart as probably Ray and Egon in terms of IQ level.
I was just going to say, too, if you listen to the sound in this sequence here as they're sat down in this living room, you'll notice that all the sound effects are dialed right down. You can't hear anything. It's basically just dialogue. It almost becomes like a sitcom.
Mm.
And later on, the sequences with just her in the room, they whack up all the sound effects as high as, you know.
Yeah.
And they keep the...
Everyone's got a crap
they
out. Keep,
and they have wall-to-wall music during the sequence as well. And it's all playful and it's all tonally happy. And again, they obliterate that when she's on her own. So they really play with it.
There's moments of the score where it feels like they have... Like Elmer's composed a piece, but then they've kind of cut it up and just dropped parts here and there where the director wanted, because there's moments where it feels like it's part of another piece and suddenly it changes into something else.
Well, there was pop cues, weren't there, that he wrote that didn't get used.
Yeah.
Funk tracks.
Might have to cut things out, yeah.
Replaced with other soundtrack songs.
Rick Moranis comes out, locked himself out again. He's got to stand there awkwardly.
I love the blocking too. I love how he's in the foreground too.
Because see, Venkman didn't even look at him. He just doesn't pay attention to Mick Moranis.
Thompson Twins, In the Name of Love, on the background on the soundtrack.
Great soundtrack that is.
And again, you know, we're going back to business. This is the last of the petty cash. They need a job. The phone rings as soon as they say that, and it's dialed so down that you don't really hear it. A beautiful shot, this, of Annie Potts. Just all in one shot. So beautifully directed. And it ends on that great close-up.
It's a really cosy kind of atmosphere, isn't it, there?
Yeah. But it's a dark environment, too, but it's not lit like, say, the library would be.
No.
It's really clever. They manipulate the space so well. And they use production design so well in this film. Iconic shot. I love the bemusement on their faces. It's the worst thing that can happen to them in many ways because they've never done it before. They've got no, you know, only one of them seems to have arrogance replacing management skills, and they're straight into it.
And they haven't had a successful test of the equipment.
No,
so
it's all unlicensed.
The seat of their pants, but that great shot of the Ecto-1, the doors open, that smoky backlit lighting as well. It's great.
With cleaning up the town,
that's the last thing of the film here, don't they?
And then they arrive at the Sedgwick, which is actually filmed in Los Angeles.
It's a different hotel, isn't it?
Interior.
Yeah.
But again, it's a really brownstony looking building. There's no glass.
Yeah, it fits well within New York. Yeah, because you'd be none the wiser.
I mean, look at that. It's like, that's proper Art Deco. And
oh, yeah.
I mean, it's Deco kind of Gothic architecture that they managed to just single out.
There's very similar architecture they use in kind of things like Blade Runner for street level scenes, which they retrofit.
Yeah. But they have that in Blade Runner. They have it existing with other stuff. Whereas
of course, yeah.
There's no contrast of anything. They just use these kind of Victorian 1920s, 1930s. You know, these kind of really old buildings that are all kind of grey and brown. Yeah. And
well, that goes with the thing of the haunted house. There's always you go in like a really old house. You think, oh, it's got to be haunted. This place, you know.
Yeah. The sense of space throughout is incredible too. I mean, on this, when they go up the elevator onto the other level, you're anticipating just getting to the ghost, aren't you? Each time.
Oh yeah. Have you seen some of the deleted scenes?
Yeah.
Yeah, where you've got the extra bits with Slimer like attacking that couple in their bedroom.
Yeah.
It's all a bit strange, that is, you know. I think there's one where Veichman and Bill Murray and Dan Aykroyd are playing like tramps, aren't they, or something like that.
There's also, I think, too, they set up the other thing, you know, that you forget now is the branding of Ghostbusters. When the film was being made, there wasn't a Ghostbusters pop culture phenomenon, obviously, because the film hadn't been made. But
there was the other cartoon, though, wasn't there? It was
but that was completely unrelated.
I mean, sure.
In terms of this logo, the song, even just the language. I mean, as you said before, setting up the language of things, the proton packs they wear, the headsets they wear, you know, the trap. All the grammar of none of this kind of existed. So an audience is seeing this fresh, and the way the film lays it out without having to tell you all the time about what's going on is quite something. I mean, they never have. There's never a sequence before this where you see the trap, is there?
No, not at all.
So it's all, you know,
the only bit you see is actually Egon kind of working on a proton pack at the table, which is having their dinner. So that's kind of just showing you a little bit of the equipment.
Whereas I think possibly, you know, in another film, they would have had a sequence where they said, this is how this works. This is how... Da, 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 da.
Of course.
They'd have a graphical illustration of the
trap. Well, that's what we've already kind of seen in the... Because we're recording this before the new Ghostbusters comes out. But in the trailers, it shows you them using the equipment and what it does.
So you're sure of what goes on, you know, before you see it. But the idea of all this stuff, like the bending particle beams and all this kind of thing.
Yeah.
You know, I mean... This is hard. Like, it's a really complicated visual idea to get across. You know, when you think about catching a fish, if you were to ground it down to ways that people would universally accept it, I mean, you've got something like a fish net, or you've got a fish line with a hook on it. You know, if they'd had a device with a laser hook or something, you know, it would get across like a universal line. But this isn't an easy to digest idea.
Well, no, because you look at some of the old designs, you know, for the Ghostbusters, it was radically different and far more, a lot more basic actually than the sort of storyboards they did, because during the time it was called Ghost Mashers. which is a bit of an odd name, but
the other thing I was going to say too is just because we got Slimer on the screen, and seems bad not to mention him at this point. There's an inconsistency of the ghosts and Ghostbusters. So he mentioned how they, you know, you see a lot of
dead people
who are kind of Victorian.
We've got like a zombie later on, haven't we? Like
probably the youngest ghost in the whole thing. But here we've actually got something that looks kind of almost interdimensional. It's abstract. It's got no basis on a real human being.
No other film had done that, though, had they? Because if you saw a ghost, it's always a person. This one had monsters.
But it is inconsistent. It's like...
It is inconsistent, yeah. And that's what kind of makes it actually really kind of original and fun.
Yeah. But the rules of it are kind of not quite clear.
Oh, yeah, the rules are all over the place.
But
it ties in with the original idea of the film, wasn't it? It was supposed to be going to different dimensions in the original script and going through space and stuff. So these are supposed to be kind of alien creatures, maybe to a certain degree, but it's also the concept of other dimensional beings.
But it's like with the cartoon show and everything else that followed.
Yeah.
They kept to the rule set up. I mean, it makes sense in this because you've got Gozer at the end who has come from another dimension.
Yeah.
So to a degree, you could see that they'd be released from that.
Yeah.
But later on, when you've got Viggo from Carpathia, what's that got to do with this? You know.
Yeah.
And in all of the Ghostbuster cartoons, they became a lot more abstract. They became less based on real people. They just became these abstract monsters.
Oh, yeah.
There isn't a clear rule. There's never, nobody. The other thing too is they never like talk about each ghost as a person. Nobody's ever personified.
They're only kind of discussed in terms of their threat level, or is a class 5 full roaming vapor.
But you never say this is Jim. We can, Jim Smith from Brooklyn. we found his daughter. We could get him to speak to. Da, da, da. You know, there's no. They're not personified. They're just almost like the Nazis are seen in the Indiana Jones films. They're just disposable, they're not human beings.
It goes with, because they essentially are just firefighters, but they're catching ghosts.
Yeah.
So that, putting out a fire, you're not going to be discussing that building and that, itself. So
don't you think it's amazing that an audience bought this idea? Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I love the film, but I'm just, when you actually think about it, when you actually break it down.
Well, I think if they had a clear vision at the beginning, and when they approached Columbia, Columbia would have gone, what? But because Columbia gave them the money based on just having this cast and this idea about catching ghosts. And boof, there you go. So if they had a full explanation of what everything was going to be, then it may have been seen as a huge risk.
Yeah.
Think, how are we going to market this movie,
Love the complete disregard they got for private property
really
as
have,
well.
Haven't they? Yeah, they don't give a toss. Just throw stuff everywhere.
Those visual effects are just incredible, aren't they?
Yeah, the liquid passing through Slimer.
I mean, it's all been said a million times before, but these just incredible. Really are incredible visual effects.
I always love how Slimer's completely knackered.
Do you know what I also love about the visual effects in this? Even though, I mean, there are artifacts that you've got from the optical era and whatnot that are in there, and there are matte lines and whatever. Just the level of imagination and creativity.
Yeah.
It just cancels all of that out.
It really does, yeah. Because with Slimer, because once you see him kind of static and stuff, he's all animated, isn't he? But when he starts getting hit or moves around really quickly, it becomes this kind of really crude kind of rotoscope animation. But you don't really care because you've already been sold on the image of him. And the first shot when you see him, that had to be the moment where you had to believe what you were seeing was a ghost, and it works so well.
This is the party trick that Peter pulled there, pulling the...
the flowers are still standing.
Yeah, but doing it at the expense of a customer.
Oh, of course.
I mean, they're really getting into it now. They're feeling at this point, you get the sense that they're not just working as a team. Because, as I said before, I don't think that the Ghostbusters really want to... their priority, certainly Peter's, is not to get rid of ghosts.
Mm.
The priority is to deal with the clients as best as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah, to give customer service, to give great customer service. That's what it's about. Again, look, the trap.
I think Ray's got the passion to catch ghosts. That's what he loves doing, I think.
Oh, those two do,
Egon, yeah.
But the goal as a service.
Yeah.
It's almost like it doesn't matter if you destroy the hotel. It doesn't matter. Ultimately, they're going to catch the ghost.
Mm. But Egon's always, I think, has always been harder to read about his real goals and what he wants. He just kind of enjoys the tech side of things and finding out more information, research. Because as soon as he finds something, he wants to analyze it and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, they generally aren't. They're scientists. Yeah. They're actual scientists. But you also feel the confidence of the Ghostbusters, and they're feeling their what they're worth. They're pricing themselves up.
Yeah, because now is when they because Egon's deciding the cost here, isn't he? Because you can see him putting his fingers up to tell him four.
Yeah, I mean, he's grafting what knowledge he's always being led, isn't he? Sort of.
Yeah.
But these, as we said before, Ray and Egon, they're not people, not front of house people.
No, they're not. No.
They wouldn't know how to deal with clients.
Egon didn't say a word.
But I think it's fascinating. Again, I just think all the ghost stuff is secondary to this is what it's really about. And they're getting into the swing of it. They're getting, now we've got this great montage sequence. Don't just love how Sigourney Weaver is framed at the bottom right. She comes into frame and out of frame doing her aerobics. So clever. But it's about the branding. We're seeing that logo. We're hearing the theme tune playing.
Yeah. And it's a quick way to sort of pass through time and show them catching more ghosts without actually spending any money on effects. You don't see any ghosts being captured here.
But it's about like confidence and assurance, you know.
Oh, sure.
And seeing that brand and knowing Ghostbusters, we believe in it. Even it, you know, it does feel like there isn't a plan really all the time. In the actual science of it, it's almost like, look, we're going to get it. We're going to.
Oh, yeah.
I like some of the designs that I saw for the, you know, the outtake kind of montage, the deleted scene montage stuff that they did for this,
with
the flying Chinatown ghost and those kind of things.
Oh, was there?
Yeah,
because there is a publicity shot where they're stepping out of the car and it's kind of this haunted house, isn't there? Or like a fort? What did you say earlier? It was like a fort or something like that.
Fort, yeah.
Before we did the commentary, I was like,
well, that's the scene with the they use in this with the angel
in hanging. Their dream, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. I also really, really like, this is just in terms of filming, I love how so much of the film is shot on location with these long zoom lenses.
Yeah.
And it just gives it a sort of documentary feel. I mean, that kind of was documentary at that time. It wasn't, you know, the shaky cam handheld thing that you see now. It gives it a kind of reality to it.
Well, I always maintain that this film is one of the best at capturing the spirit and feel of New York, more so than others. Number two as well does it just as successfully.
But again, but not showing the real New York, you know, New York.
Yeah. But when you see this film, though, because also you were saying earlier on, because the locations are all scattered around the place in reality, but in this they're quite close.
It feels like it's a homogenized kind of massive ghost house.
Yeah.
You know, it makes the whole island of Manhattan feel like a giant, you know, turn of the century
Ghostbusters sandbox game, isn't it? This is a scene where, okay, this film isn't really aimed at kids, you know, getting a sexual favour from a ghost.
Yeah, it's just kind of awkward if you've got a child around.
Yeah.
But that was a bit from a deleted scene where they go to a fort, and I believe when they come back and they're talking about the apocalypse with Winston on the bridge, I think that came after that.
What do you think?
Don't quote me, go and look online, okay. read about it. And the introduction of Winston.
Now, you'd think many other people would be knocking at the door wanting to work for Ghostbusters, and he just walks straight in and gets the job, you know.
I don't know, he's a kind of fearless person, isn't he? And
well, Ernie Hudson, you know, he has a kind of a love-hate relationship with this film and the sequel, because he loves the opportunity he was given and being part of such a great franchise. But he's kind of not given much to do in both of them, and Cole was kind of sidelined. And he also is really weird with the marketing. He's always, in this one especially, he's always excluded.
Well, he wasn't a star, so to speak, as the other people, which they're obviously marking the film on.
Yeah.
And then it became something else, didn't it? And of course, their likenesses weren't used for the TV show either.
No. Well, so they became. Ernie Hudson did audition for the cartoon, but he didn't get it. Which is weird, isn't it?
That is odd.
That is
really
odd.
Is that true?
Yeah, it's true. And he had to shave his moustache for number two, because he had to look like the character from the cartoon.
But it's interesting how the characters in the cartoon became as well known and loved by children as the actual actors playing them, probably more so.
I think they said they had a bit of an identity crisis with number two, because they're not doing an adaptation of the cartoon. They're not following that. They're doing from the first movie, but the kids are so familiar with the cartoon. Seeing this Ghostbusters 2 is not actually like the cartoon.
It's kind of a bit like Ninja Turtles 2 in a kind of thing. This is a great scene with Timothy Carhart, who was the bad guy in Thelma and Louise, who
sees
around and kills.
He's in Beverly Hills Cop, wasn't he?
He's a villain in Beverly Hills Cop 3. Yeah. And I love the fact that he's doing his whole thing with his sinus cleaning.
Sinus problems,
yeah.
It's taken a long time for, because they have actually dragged out her job, you know, because that montage could have been over, what, 3 or 4 weeks or a month or two? Mm. We don't know how much passage of time has gone past. And now they're finally just, oh yeah, we just read this from a book, here's some information for you, you know.
Yeah.
But nothing else has happened to her, though. That's the interesting thing.
She's a great, you know what they call a straight man.
Mm.
She plays everything deadpan, and Bill Murray's playing everything much bigger, and she puts so much reality and restraint on it. And then you got the cutaway to Timothy Carhart, who's just completely negative.
Yeah, yeah.
But I like these sequences are fun because they feel like they're out of a straight romantic comedy. They feel like they feel smaller. There's nothing fantastical in these moments. There's no ghosts. No. It's all real people. That's a great thing. That's the other great thing about this film is it does a tonal tightrope.
Mm.
It can be a broad comedy at one side with fantastical monsters in it.
It can be a horror in one moment as well.
Yeah, and then it's just down with real people. The other side. It's a great setting, this too, with the fountains in the middle.
I always thought that the guy she's with at the moment, I thought she married him in the sequel and then he left her and because they had the kid Oscar. But that was just my mad kind
of
fan theory.
Is that not what happened?
Well, no, because he's. I don't think his name's mentioned in the second one. I'm not sure. Someone listening can leave a comment and let me know.
And this is setting up the containment unit.
It's tiny, isn't it? Because it's all obviously in the where the ghosts are going is beyond the wall. Because later on, because it all blows out the bricks, doesn't it? But because it does look really small, but in the cartoon, it's huge. And in number two, you never see it. It's quite.
But it's. I like the way how they could have had a sequence at the beginning where they explain how the trap works, how the proton packs work, how you trap a ghost, how you stick it into the containment unit, and they don't do that. They use it as a sequence to explain to Winston as a new recruit.
Yeah, very clever. And
so you're watching Winston the whole time and not the containment unit.
And he's doing it very just sort of half-assed, isn't he? Like if you've ever been to started a new job, like especially in retail or whatever, and they're just like the staff member just shows you around like half-assed, goes this goes here, that goes there, you've got to try and remember everything,
Yeah, here we go, Pac. So this is another one where people say that this is a Reagan era pro-capitalist, pro-business film because the bad guy. The real, if you want to...
And the government people, really.
It's the EPA.
Yeah.
And it's the idea of regulating business being a bad thing. And
yeah, because all for deregulation, that's what kind of everyone's, profits and
but,
money
went
through the roof.
To be fair, they've got unlicensed nuclear,
because Veichman screws it all up. Because if he'd just let him go downstairs and observe what was going on, this may have never happened and they would have never got released. But because of... Veichman doesn't like to be challenged.
I read in the making in that brilliant book you've got, by the way, an amazing book that's just somewhere near my feet down there.
Oh, it's the Visual Guide to Ghostbusters, written by Daniel Wallace, which is an amazing read.
Apparently, there was a sequence. I think from reading that, I think it's where I read that. Mm. This fact again, don't quote me. Get that book; it's a brilliant book. Apparently, there's a sequence where he was meant to go down. And look inside the... Peck was supposed to go down and look inside the containment unit and he'd see a bunch of lost souls inside of there. Oh. And then he'd just dismiss it as being television. So...
That plays into this whole thing being a light show and things like that later on.
Yeah. So... I don't know. I mean, I'm neutral about Peck. I think, these... Veichman isn't a responsible... businessman. I don't think Veichman... I frankly don't think Veichman cares either about the environment. I don't think we've seen that. He's just, you see him go around destroying things.
And I think he's also caught Veichman off guard as well, because Veichman's obviously clearly knackered and stuff, and he's just like short tempered and he just goes, I want to, I'll come here to check what you're doing. And he's just gone, no, piss off,
But it's the that's the brilliant absurdity of it, because it's like regulating
authority as well.
It's regulating business for effectively saving the world, And at this point in the film, they aren't saving the world. It's almost like they're getting rid of inconvenience. At the moment, they're making the world a little bit better because they're getting rid of these.
People can sleep at night,
The
kitchen won't be left in a mess.
Yeah, yeah. But it isn't like they haven't hinted at the apocalypse or anything else at this point.
Not at all, no. Because it's the one that kind of brings it all into question is Winston. He quizzes, talks about revelations and the end of the world.
But this is the thing. They kind of desensitize you to ghosts in some ways, or the idea of a ghost existing. The other thing that's quite interesting about the film is it's completely it's localized to New York. There's no threat, and in both films it never goes, it's never,
never
a nationwide
goes beyond
thing.
Never goes to New Jersey or whatever.
It never goes to England. It never goes to
the original idea for number two, they were supposed to go to England.
Really?
It completely changed the direction. Yeah.
And of course now we're introduced, well, we'd seen the dogs at the beginning, the gargoyles,
sure,
which aren't really gothic. They're kind of playing more into exaggerated art deco.
Mm.
But this is where, you know, we're...
It's classic Ray Harryhausen monster coming, you know, coming to get them.
Oh, this is one of my favourite scenes. Well, the whole film is a favourite scene.
One long favourite moment.
But I love the sequence with Lewis and his party.
Oh,
and the way he's so shameless. Again, the whole thing of keeping up with the Joneses. And it's, you know, as I said, I think the film is really about, you know, saying that there's more to life than cynically making a living or being dead. And I think that, you know, with him, he even says this is a networking thing. He's got all of his clients there. And he sort of humiliates and degrades them as they, you know, as they come in.
But how does Dana fit into that world, though? Because everyone else is all about making money and stuff.
Well, she is a working professional, isn't she? But, yeah, she's an artist as well. She's somewhere in the middle.
Mm.
Actually, interestingly as well, in the sequel, she's not a musician. She retrains as an artist.
Yeah, which takes years to do, apparently, but she does it within the space of 5 years.
Yeah. And again, as we said before, sound is right down when we were in Dana's room. And
look at that lighting outside as well. It's beautiful.
And then I like the way, too, that just in shooting it, Ivan Reitman puts her in a very vulnerable position. He, you know, we see a lot of the back of her neck. We're looking in the shadows in the corner of the room, and that brilliant phone ring, which just spikes out when everything's down and you're waiting. You're then listening in. Because what you do as an audience member when the sound is so down, you then
Your ears get attuned to any sound that's going to kick in.
Yeah, well, you're almost kind of like you're bringing the sound up by listening to it.
Yeah,
I notice too this crab shot where it goes around her. This
brilliant sets up because you know but it's the back audience of her head. See before she does. He's, what's there.
It's behind you, you know. And then
And
then we move around and we've got I mean it's great, it's just a vulnerable position to put her in. But I don't think again, I just think even though it is a damsel in distress part to a degree, even though she's very level headed, I think that Sigourney Weaver just adds nuances into her performance.
She's one of those actresses who's aged extremely well. Even she's like, you know, when she did Alien, she was like I think maybe like 30 years old.
Oh, yeah, she's incredibly youthful. Yeah. But I mean, just in terms of her performance.
Yeah, of course, some,
I mean, even now when you see the demons rip out, you know, the arms rip out. You never feel like she's going to, you know, she's so weak she's going to die. You feel worried for her.
Yeah,
you're scared.
Yeah.
But you feel like you're her, you know. It's absolutely terrifying. Have you seen, I think it's Cannibal Girls that Ivan Reitman directed?
No, I'm not seeing that, no. Have you seen Evolution, which they tried to redo Ghostbusters?
I've not seen that.
Yeah, they tried
to redo. Is it good?
It's okay, completely bombed, but they tried to use that kind of Ghostbuster formula again, and it didn't work out very well.
Oh, I just love this party scene, it's brilliant. This is Rick Moranis just firing on all cylinders. My favourite characters in the franchise are probably Ted and Annette Fleming. I think they're amazing. I'm generally looking forward to the Paul Feig Ghostbusters film. I think he's an amazing director, and I think that film is going to be, you know, if it's anything like Spy or you know The Heat,
I love Spy.
It's going to be great. I have full confidence in him. However, I'm going to be incredibly disappointed if he does not have a cameo as Ted Fleming.
Because in the film, Tim pointed this out, Ted Fleming looks just like Paul Feig.
Not just like, but there's a
similarity there.
It just seems like a gold thing. Like, what a waste. Why would you make that film and not, you know? I mean, essentially, I'm saying he's a suited guy in glasses.
Yeah.
But I also love here, you know, Lewis puts him down. You know, he's, again, status. He's talking about their business failures. He's an accountant.
He has no shame, does he?
Yeah, but he works as an accountant, you know.
Yeah.
And He's doing, and he actually says, doesn't he? But they're okay, you know. He assesses their finances in front of everybody.
He also acted completely blind to the lady who's interested in him, didn't he? He's like, okay, and just starts dancing and walks off. You know?
Well, he wouldn't know what to do either. You know?
Yeah, he's infatuated with Dana. That's probably the weakest shot in the film, I think, with the stop motion and the.
Relatively, I just love that massively sized animatronic of the dog. Oh, I think it's brilliant. Yeah. It's so huge, and the sound as well, the sound design, you know, it's got that...
It's basically a lion mixed with other sound effects.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But, which is great for those monsters, but in that number two, they used the same sound effect for Viggo, which always drove me nuts.
Well, it's kind of a standard thing in horror films, isn't it, that everything sounds like a raptor from... kind Jurassic of, yeah, Park. Yeah.
This sequence is really clever because it's obviously just an open air thing.
You've got posh society there where they just completely ignore him, you know, as
but,
well.
But he's in full view of everyone there. And even though, you know, it's not really a scary environment, but he's outside of it. And it's making you think as a viewer, is he only seeing the dog? Because they all turn away, don't they, afterwards?
Well, because you don't see... Because you think you would have seen the red eyes, wouldn't you?
But you're feeling... How it's you know, the demons break into his psyche and the feeling of possession. They communicate possession really well in the film.
Yeah, they do.
Because you just in that reverse shot, you saw the dog was there, and then when you cut back and see the crowd, they can't see it.
Well, it's like, yeah, because the dog's gone inside him, isn't it? So it's like.
But this is it. This is what I'm saying. The film has got so much visual storytelling in this film where they're setting up a grammar and rules that's so complicated to just articulate, you know. I just think now if they
have a huge paragraph for every detail of things,
but they do it.
They do it visually.
Yeah.
Which is a difficult skill. It's a difficult thing to do.
Yeah.
And only a small number of directors can actually do it, you know, on a frequent basis.
This is so funny how Sigourney Weaver slams the door on his, well, she closes it on his face. It's kind of like, okay, whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
I love her costume too. She looks like the Acid Queen from, you know, Tina Turner in Tommy.
But she's weird thing is though, because at the end of the film when she comes out the dog, she's actually still wearing the outfit. So either was it something she already owned and she's put on? I don't know. Or being possessed by the dog has kind of made her turn into this thing, you know.
Well, it's that kind of attire, isn't it, for the world. It makes me wonder what Zool would be wearing. And
well, yeah.
Is it Vince Clortho?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Keymaster.
Oh, that sound effect when you see the slime.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that beautiful musical cue. Because this whole sequence here, you know, as I was saying earlier, it's not really aimed at children. The film wasn't marketed at them. There was no toys to tie in with the movie. It wasn't until the real Ghostbusters became popular, the cartoon, then the toys came out. But when kids saw this, there was nothing to go buy, like a proton pack or an action figure. They just had t-shirt tie-ins and things like that, and the regular things that come out with most films. So this sequence here was really, as a kid, I didn't really understand it, what was going on, you know. And she's just asking him to, you know, she wants him inside her and stuff like that. Raunchy,
but it's also the most sort of blatant nod to The Exorcist.
It is, yeah.
Which we haven't mentioned at all.
No, we haven't. No,
but I think, I mean, obviously, that it gets to a point. There's levitation. She does the, you know, she does the
growling.
The voice. Yeah.
But I'm also wondering, did they have the sound effect off on set when she did the growling? Because the expression on her face, it seems like she's miming to it.
She probably dubbed. I mean, yeah, she probably said it out loud and then was overlaid afterwards.
But the weird thing is, because the new Ghostbusters film has a reference to The Exorcist, as she, you know, she slaps Melissa McCarthy and the ghost comes out, which is, you know, an Exorcist kind of nod. But some people suddenly forget this one also had even bigger reference to The Exorcist with kind of like a direct copy of that.
But I also think, I mean, a friend of mine was saying to me as well, just also in the direction of the film and the way it sets up, it's reality. It's kind of fake. It's verisimilitude.
Yeah.
It's
very believable.
Similar, yeah.
Believable world. And that's what we're saying. You know, to me, it sort of captures the spirit of New York. Everything just feels so real and grimy and gritty.
Do you know what else, though? Yeah, I guess, because I was going to mention religion as well.
Sure.
And because ghosts, religion. There is no mention of it.
When any Winston is,
but up until this point,
no, yeah, you know, that's true.
And now we're thinking about it because it's the, you know, because it's the
Exorcist. Now dealing with gods, aren't we? Now,
yeah,
it comes into that.
Well,
that,
the question would be, you know, would
that chapter,
you know, could she be exorcised at this point? You know, but then later on, it doesn't ignore religion. It goes back to it. I mean, there are things that happen later.
Religion's
on
in the background. You know, it's never like put forward to say, hey, we're going to do something like a, as you're saying, like an exorcism. It's nothing ever kind of thought
about. No, because it's seen as a rational, I mean, this is the thing, it's making the irrational rational, and the whole idea is that they're scientists as well, and they've got a business that, you know, eradicates it. But it's I don't know. Have you seen the new Conjuring 2?
No, but I know you said it was absolutely terrifying, didn't you?
Yeah.
Would you see a parallel with that, with the discussion of religion or...
Yeah, I guess what I'm saying is a lot of horror films that deal with kind of possession, and it becomes a possession film at this point, it usually, you know, leads itself to...
I find things with horror films, I'm not a religious guy at all, but anything that deals with, you know, like the devil or things like that, terrified the shit out of me. I don't know why, you know, or like you know, like poltergeists terrify me. Yeah.
Sorry, not religion. I was saying about just mythology, you know, and the idea of demons and well, I mean, in Conjuring, you've got that whole thing with the demon nun,
yeah,
you know, but there isn't any. It's done in a very, I guess, almost like a clinical, sterile kind of way here, where it's the corporate Ghostbusters get rid of the ghost, but the whole city looks like a giant haunted house.
It's
interesting.
It really pushes the fantasy element near the end, doesn't it? Because Ray kind of comes across as, you know, he knows religion, but he's not you know, one to doesn't practice in it. You know, he's fully aware of like the Bible and stuff, where Winston's the one who's kind of, you know, he's the man from the streets, he's the one who believes in God. And he's the one that kind of reinforces the end of the world scenario by relating it back to the Bible, and they're like, oh my God, you know.
I love the display. Did you notice when Lewis is having the scan done?
Yeah, with the dog.
And there's that infrared one of the dog in the background.
It's like the Predator vision, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's mirrored exactly.
Yeah, I know, he timed it well.
Wonderful.
I don't know what computer he's using there. It looks like a really old, maybe a Apple II or something.
Yeah. It's a very fun film, isn't it? It's got so much stuff going in it, but it's the ideas are dark.
Oh yeah,
it's
yeah.
real black.
It moves along at a quick pace. It's not like it's under 2 hours. There's so many like gags thrown in. Into the film, like subtly as well. We know we're saying sort of black comedy and things like that. It's not a full out blown comedy in your face with slap. There's no kind of slapstick stuff.
There is a lot of, I mean, you know, slime getting squirted in the eyes, sliming.
Yeah, but it's not like kind of, I suppose, like the more kind of recent kind of comedy kind of teen movies, which is all kind of, you know, over the top. It's all kind of downplayed.
Yeah.
That comedy level is still there to sort of get the big belly laughs.
It's a lot of things that shouldn't, on paper, just shouldn't work, and they just do.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Do you think some of the kind of dialogues ad-libbed at all on set? Or do you think there's kind of...
Quite possibly. I was just going to say, we got the picture there of Dana when she's a child.
Oh, I completely missed that.
Yeah.
I was gabbing away.
I don't know why, but just doing things like that, it helps you... I don't know,
It also shows that Wakeman's managed to put her under control. He's managed to restrain her, you know.
And he has
done.
Morals as well.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because...
But he's still joking as well within that, because he's like, you know, he's being very serious, but he says, oh, we got to put these two together, you know, and Egon's like, that would be extraordinarily dangerous. So, you know, he's still joking when he's trying to be serious.
You know, it could become an undignified situation. You know, her dignity is being compromised in the way that she's been taken over by this being.
Yeah.
And he wants to preserve that.
That's a DX7 there as well, that bomb, right. The beginning bit.
Well, this is the great scene, isn't it, where they talk about the apocalypse.
Yeah. There's a great moment here. And this is also setting up the moment where, because later on, because they're looking at the architectural plans of the building. And Ray's still continuing with the investigation for Dana, so they had not forgotten about her, because they haven't communicated, because, you know, Wakeman and Egon haven't told these guys what's going on,
and Winston admits, you know, that he's very much into the Bible as well.
Yeah,
so I was saying before, I mean, I don't want to give away too many of these things as they come, but the shift, you know, the kind of the ghostbusting is becoming more and more trivialized. I think at this point, this is the turning point, because they realize, you know, once
Winston puts this theory across.
Yeah.
That this isn't a, this isn't isolated instance of ghosts. This is one big.
It's building thing. Up to something. Yeah, you know, yeah. It's something's coming, and but the last time we see any ghosts is really when they escape from the building. Ghostbusters headquarters, and you see like what you see Slimer again. You see one come out the subway, and then there's the kind of the undead zombie one in the taxi.
I was just gonna say it's really funny too how that great exposition scene. It's all just dialogue in a car.
Yeah.
I like the fact that it's diffused by that jazz music.
Oh yeah, yeah. And he's like just put the radio on, and Winston's like, yeah, okay. He just like told him to basically shut up. You know, he's spooking Ray out.
I love this great scene with Peck. I love how it's set up. Again, it's just all visual. You know, you've got just one shot and Peck comes into a shot. You got an authority walks over, hands him a folder.
It was great use of the anamorphic format as well.
Yeah.
Everything's placed out really well.
It's really, really well staged. Just here as well. I mean, just a simple thing like look at the massive distance they have to walk. This is going to kill screen time. Yeah. I mean, now they, you know, they do it in a they jump cut or whatever.
Oh, cool.
It's like 5 seconds where he's just walking along.
There's one thing I remember because we were talking about kind of staging and how they used a lens. A lot of directors used to like go crazy with putting stuff, actors in on the far left and far right, just to fuck with the TV broadcast people because when they put the pan and scan because they hated it, the directors would just make, okay, well, I'm going to do this. But then when they put it on TV, they have to do loads of artificial pans all the time.
Yeah. But also, I love the way that Reitman uses it creatively, too. He uses it for really comedy does. Reasons.
Because comedy films don't generally used to come in 2351. They'd always be 185.
Well, you know, if you look at Billy Wilder and Blake Edwards on their films. And they
had Pink Panthers, yeah. Yeah. But most of the ones I kind of saw in that during that period were kind of 185, you know, didn't really warrant using an anamorphic.
Well, certainly in the early 80s, yeah. Aside from those Pink Panther movies, yeah. I think the sequence is really good. It's really scary. And it's the other cool thing is as well, ghosts, they're seen as nocturnal beings. And this film breaks the rule.
Kind of during the day, yeah.
Yeah. They make ghosts work during the day.
Yeah, yeah.
I think also, too, ghosts, they're traditionally seen as being, as kind of dwelling in kind of confined areas, you know, a haunted house, they'll be in a room.
Like you always have to, you know, people always get spooked out by it. You watch TV shows where people go looking for ghosts, it's always have to do it with the lights off, don't they?
But you have to go into a room and it's, you know, and it's really claustrophobic, whereas here it's like the idea of them being out in the open.
Actually, it's far more scary if the ghosts are coming during the day, you know what I mean? You're kind of...
I was going to say James Wan again in Insidious, that dancing boy in the house, you know. You never feel safe, you know.
Exactly. That's why things made things like Paranormal Activity work, because you're getting, like, they're getting attacked in their bed, you know. That's like another, spooky moment.
This has all been set up before earlier as well. Just, I mean, again, we all know what's going to happen now because it's all been shown visually. And they don't just tell it. There are bits where they tell you through spoken exposition, but they show it. And they don't show you it once, you know. They don't show it multiple times to get the point across about the containment unit and how the ghosts work. That's a great shot, isn't it?
It's hilarious running. But Vic Moranis is kind of a bit slow one out.
There's no mortality created by ghosts either. Nobody dies because of the ghosts.
I remember like the idea for the third one where Bill Murray didn't want to be in it. He wanted to be killed off in the first reel and he'd just be a ghost throughout the rest of the film.
I don't know. I mean, don't you think that would break the grammar of ghosts? Like, all these ghosts are just, they're pure evil. They're a nuisance and they're evil. Yeah. They're not personified. They're not human beings. They're not the souls of human beings. They're like the pure evil.
But Ghostbusters 2 kind of broke the rule where they had Janos being... A ghost, like Victorian, like nurse or nanny, whatever.
This music here.
Oh, it's brilliant.
Awesome. There's a great shot here of the car, police car's coming down with the low sun.
Yeah.
I just find that a bit kind of apocalyptic.
Mm.
It's just so ominous, isn't it? You just know, this is like one of the best, everything is going, you know, something really bad's going to happen. And they built it up as that too.
But this is the first time we see Egon actually show any emotion, where he actually cracks.
That's true.
Because he never does that in the sequel. He never.
But it's the practicality of it too.
You know, he's just, you know. It's kind of just driven him over the edge.
Well, also it shows a. It's funny because Peter Venkman shows a complete disregard for what Egon and Ray do, and they don't have any problem with that. But if Peck does it,
Yeah, yeah.
They're really upset.
A great 65mm shot.
That's a beautiful. I mean, that's a beautiful image, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is.
The music here, this, because that it's called Magic, isn't it? The tune is on the album, but this moment is the best part of the track for me.
But yeah, as we said, we're seeing all ghosts, and they're all in the middle of the day. I mean, we break.
It's kind of weird because that was a weird thing, because it was like a spirit that kind of went in there, then appeared
in a tactile form.
Yeah.
But and there is
no rules, is there?
They're all inconsistent. No, yeah. they're just pure evil.
Yeah.
I mean, surely that could have been somebody's best friend, you know.
Yeah.
It's that thing, it's that walking that line of, I don't know, I don't want to say there's walking the line of bad taste in a Ghostbusters movie, but it does kind of walk a line, it has its own line of bad taste that it doesn't, you know, it has its own rules. I love those visuals, the things flying around are just amazing. It's quite rock video-ish too, isn't it? The fact that they've not used it, Elmer Bernstein music, and they've actually got a pop track over the top.
Yeah, they really have.
And it makes it really effective. I don't know why. So at this point, as I said before, this is no longer a Ghostbusters film.
No, the ghosts are all gone now. No more ghosts.
Yeah.
So this is full on. So
there is no
God
reason to have
movie.
A Ghostbuster franchise anymore.
Yeah, this is where it all kind of crumbles for them. And they get lumped with the bill, come number two, you know, to pay for all the damages. Which I still kind of was frustrated by, because you know, everyone kind of saw what happened. You know, you think you wouldn't disregard all this damage and seeing a Stay Puft Marshmallow Man walking around and think, oh, it's all their fault, let's make them pay for it, you know.
This is a great exposition sequence.
I love this moment here, yeah.
Do you know what makes it even funnier? The fact that they're doing this sequence with everyone around them. And I think in a different film, I think you'd have some of the other people in the jail come forward and be a physical threat and actually get in the way. And then they'd have to make a point of it, you know. Whereas here, they're just looking on aghast.
Yeah, it's like they're all kind of intrigued by what Ray's talking about and Egon. And obviously, they're not, like Vakeman, they're not as bright as Ray and Egon. So they don't understand what's going on. They just kind of let them do their own thing.
But also, too, I mean, that's the other thing. In a different film, you could have portrayed everybody else in the jail as like the jail scene in Death Wish 3.
Or even like Trading Places, where they kind of, Eddie Murphy shoved in there and he pretends to be all big and strong and he just...
he has to be, because there's somebody intimidating. None of these people are intimidating.
Not at all, no.
I think the film is saying that the world is a really tough, it's really tough to make a living. You're either living or you're a nuisance. You know, you're either doing really, you're either Lewis and you're networking, and you're doing really, really, really well.
Yeah.
Or you're Dana, who's got this amazing, you know, she's got her apartment in Central Park.
Yeah.
And she's got this, you know, this career doing, you know, and it's all completely normal to them. And then there's dead people. And that's kind of it. And I don't know. This is great. Everyone huddles around. I know there is something subtle there. I think there is an opinion there. I don't know. I'm just, that's just me.
It's always a subtle with this. I mean, it's never kind of brought to the forefront to make that statement.
But yeah, at this point, it becomes a deity, a god busting film.
Yeah.
The
moment I hear about, you know, the architecture of the building and Evil Shandor and things like that, I always want to know more about that. But the film doesn't do that. It's giving you little.
They didn't even show you a photo of him either, did they?
No, the only time you actually see him, actually, because going back to the recent video game from 2009, it tells you all about him and what he looked like and all the other people that were part of his cult. It's so fascinating. But they obviously never explored within the third movie.
I do wonder, because I remember, I think it's in the commentary, Ivan Reitman's commentary for the film on the Blu-ray or DVD.
Yes, Blu-ray.
I remember him. I might have got this wrong, but I think that they said that they were going to have Paul Rubens, who played Pee-wee Herman, playing Evo Shandor, appearing.
That's right. Yeah,
at the end, instead of Gozer.
That's right. Yeah,
instead of the former.
Well, it's supposed to be just a guy in a suit. A guy in a suit turns up. You know, and
they realise that it's Evo Shandor.
Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, again, my feeling that the film is about.
That's not blue screen, is it, behind her? I think, is that a projection shot?
Yeah, it is a blue screen shot.
Oh, because there's no bobbly matte lines. It's all
tough stuff.
It's good. It's pretty good.
It's really, I mean, this is all optical printing as well.
Yeah. Nothing looked faded, so it looked good.
But Evo Shandor, he thought society was too sick to exist.
To survive.
And he was like a, what is he? He's a doctor, isn't he? And an architect. Yes, he's a successful businessman.
Yeah.
He's kind of done everything that he's achieved everything he can.
He wanted to go to the next level, didn't he?
Yeah. So again, I think, again, the film is made, it's saying something about that.
Yeah, because he's got, you know, he's you know, he's extremely wealthy, intelligent, and everyone below him, he's like, well, they're all too sick to survive.
Well, also just to survive.
That society.
The fact that he could be a, you know, he's a medical person who performed unnecessary surgery.
Yeah.
The fact he could get to do that.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, it's kind of like how Venkman, you know, he can have that job at the university but as a scientist, but not actually be a scientist.
It's kind of like he was an architect, but then he started doing these weird experiments and he kind of classified himself as a doctor.
Yeah, but also, I guess what I'm saying is, like, there is... Yeah, there's just that whole... I mean, the idea of, like, Ghostbusters...
Mm.
You know, the idea that the dead...
It's not something you can be trained at. They just kind of classified themselves as Ghostbusters.
The absurdity of it.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
It's talking about the absurdity of life and how we have to take ourselves seriously with disciplines in being professionals and making a living.
Yeah.
I think, you know, Eva Shandor is kind of fighting against... I don't know, I like to think this all links up. This is a great scene too, with David Margulies as the mayor.
Yeah.
And I love the Archbishop. I love how they're all on first term... name basis too, so it becomes like this, it's all about networking, you know.
Yeah, he's like, morning Mike, he just, like, you know, taps him on the cheek,
and it's all for selfish reasons. And it's also this point too where Peter, I think, has really
he fits really well within that group,
but he's blossomed because he's a networker, and he's also you know, he's integrated as a business professional, and he's good at handling these are clients.
Yeah.
And
the only way he wins them over is by saying, you know, you're going to save the lives of,
you're going to benefit
millions
from
of
this.
Registered voters.
If you let me benefit, you can benefit, and then the Archbishop, you know, can benefit.
It's interesting that the mayor's complete arsehole to them in the second one. He's completely forgotten about, you know, how he's, because he's far more, you know, impressionable in this one. He's more kind of understanding and listening to them, what they're going to say. When the second one, I suppose maybe in the second one it plays up because everyone's so bitter and angry. The mayor is as well. He's, you know, he's part of that.
That's part of the theme of the film, isn't it? They talk about, what was it, the 53rd precinct's bleeding. The walls are bleeding.
Yeah.
That's an image that you wouldn't see in the film. There's no blood, is there, in the film?
No, no.
There isn't a drop of blood in the film.
Yeah.
So again, that's kind of, it's a kind of...
There's loads of stuff kind of like that. Like they kind of just reference in spoken dialogue.
But if you saw that in this film, I think it would throw the film off.
Oh, it would be the rating of the film goes up to 15.
If you saw Ivo Shandor, you know, if you saw one of his victims who had an unnecessary surgery, that would be a different film.
Oh yeah, it'd be tonally.
I absolutely love his expression there when he mentions about the voters.
Yeah.
The Archbishop, that's so good.
I always think he's, you know, Walter Peck, his character, is great with the beard, the actor is. But when I saw him in Die Hard without his beard, he just looks strange. He needs his beard.
And now we say goodbye to the EPA.
Well, he comes back, well, later on he gets pelted with marshmallow, doesn't he? Or tons of shaving foam.
But the thing is, the Ghostbusters aren't going to benefit from this. If they get rid of that
well, they're not getting paid either.
No, but also that's the end of their businesses ceased now. That's it.
Mm.
Although they're doing it in the guise of the Ghostbusters, they are Godbusters now. This is a Godbusting film. This is an interdimensional Godbusting film. Mm. I love this sequence.
Because you have to think. You think about it. Like, what the next, the third act had to be. What could you do to give it that? You know, that next big moment and battling a god.
I was going to say about Ridgerton here. They tip their head to it because I think you see some Orthodox Jews and you see some nuns as well. So you're seeing people from different religions coming together, and I think that brings, you know, it's tastefully done. It's quite
tastefully done. Yeah.
It doesn't side with one religious mythology or well, you know,
it kind
of broadens it and keeps. The other thing I was going to say too is I think this sequence really brings together the branding of Ghostbusters. It really shows that they...
Also, this moment, it brings in the spirit of New York.
But it's morale. It's the morale. But they're bringing it up. It's working on the job and having a smiley face and looking people in the eye. That's what this is about.
Yeah, yeah.
And he says, what's the line that he says? Whatever happens, let's be professional.
Yeah.
Not let's save the world.
Yeah, yeah.
This is what I said before. It doesn't matter whether they save, if they get rid of the ghost or not. It's about being professional.
Yeah.
So you can integrate, you know.
You see, Peter's also more about keeping everyone happy because he's the only one interacting with the people where Ray and Atlot
are just kind of
a bit awkwardly waving, you know.
But look at the morale building and the logos and the branding. You know, this is like... And you look at those people in the crowd. None of them have heard that song before. It hasn't been recorded when they're doing this. Had it?
No, not at all.
So, and then nobody knows this is going to be some massive phenomenon that they've kind of... interesting because they're building up a brand that will be a... The Ghostbusters in the film are a brand.
Yeah.
The Ghostbusters as a film...
Becomes a brand itself.
Is a brand in its own right. Yeah. But then later on, they're going to
Which no one knew. The whole film was just catching lightning in a bottle. This whole thing.
Yeah, at the end of the film, they fight the Marshmallow Man, who's a completely fictitious brand.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it's blurring these kind of worlds. I think that is, I stuff like that I don't think can be completely planned, but I think...
No, that's always the thing. With all these many of these films that all became extremely successful, amazing, huge franchises, no one at the time thought it was going to be big, like it's like Star Wars, things like that. You know, you just don't know.
This is great as too because this isn't. I mean, this is kind of a sort of biblical thing.
Apocalyptic kind of stuff. You know,
but it's kind of low key too. It's kind of like the downtown version of a chest of drawers moving across a room. You know, you're not seeing an apparition or anything.
Sure.
And it gives you just a taster.
It's a taster, but on a bigger scale.
And the morale here, you know, the crowd cheering when they surface.
Mm. It also could be implied that, you know, they weren't defeated by this attack. Now, they may have like God on their side, you know.
Yeah, but again, it's not... It's not religion. It's business. It's just the morale of a corporate brand that everyone likes. Because that's what they'd be building to. I mean, I'd like to see a different Ghostbusters film. Where I'll mention that in a sec. Great shot here.
It's a great It's cut to comedy.
Yeah.
Because this big heroic moment. Like, yeah, we're going in. We're stupid. You know, everyone's really confident. They walk in. They've got to climb up like 64 flights of stairs, you know.
But can you imagine a more corporate greed version of this film where the Ghostbusters are really successful and they have tons of disposable income, they lie, you know, they take advantage of their customers, and they make massive profit, they're all driving around in sport. Can you imagine if they all had Ferraris outside the firehouse? And they lived at Trump Tower, you know.
Imagine if it became literally a franchise where other people set up their own ghostbusting companies and then these lot don't do anything about it anymore, but it goes out of control, you know.
Yeah. I mean, that would become blacker and blacker and blacker. You know, it'd become darker and darker and darker.
Sure.
It'd become almost like American Psycho with Ghostbusters, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Competing with their business cars, you know?
Yeah. But it could have gone that way. I mean, this is just when I hear people saying about this is
the business ideas about it.
Capitalist.
Yeah. That matte painting yellow we just saw. Incredible. It's Art Deco stuff here. It's beautiful. Exactly, very nice.
And pretty much all of the film now takes place above, doesn't it? On top of the
This is because you were saying it looks very much like a Prince music video.
It does. It looks like a new wave music video,
purple and things like that.
Well, Sigourney Weaver looks like one of Prince's kind of.
One of the dancers or whatever.
And especially Goza, looks like Sheena Easton by Sheila.
Yeah,
Reed,
her hair. Yeah. Well, she got with Prince, didn't she? She needs
them. This music. Yeah. So great. Use of an organ. Also, too, it's quite interesting as well. And again, I'm not sure of the truth of geography, but the fact they got a church right next door.
Yeah.
Because that's the other...
That's not actually next to the building.
Is it not?
No, I don't think so. I really don't think so.
But that's a designed element, then. That's something that's been... They've chosen to put that...
that there
form
yeah,
of
yeah,
religion
yeah.
yeah that religious building into it. I mean, it's all this stuff, you know, as I said, this is a very designed film.
Who was it designed by? A very old production designer.
John DeCur.
Yeah. Was this the last film he did?
I think it is.
Because he had designed things like Cleopatra,
didn't
he? Didn't
he die shortly after this?
Yeah, because he was in his 80s.
I'm not sure.
And still working.
And Beau Welch, who designed many films for Tim Burton.
Yeah, he did Beetlejuice, didn't he? Yeah. Ghostbusters 2 was his fourth movie.
Yeah.
I believe so. Maybe his fifth.
Look at these visual effects. They're so amazing.
I remember when I saw this on TV, when you see that shot there a minute ago, the long shot, you can see the massive black matte lines, but you can't see them on Blu-ray.
Actually, there was a transition into the skeletons.
I remember it last night. You see a quick flash of skeleton. It's a bit like Vader in Jedi. We see a quick flash of his skull when he gets attacked by the Emperor. He's a dog. To me, I mean, I always kind of thought the stop motion kind of animation in this was a bit crude in comparison to what Phil Tippett's work, especially things like Ed 209 and sort of the go motion technique. But I love that design, this kind of pyramid.
He also goes away from the that gothic kind of
It becomes brown stuff, completely different.
Well, she's a Sumerian deity, isn't she?
Yeah, so they're Asian kind of.
They're getting sort of Mesopotamian elements in there, and
and
the idea is that this is a satellite anyway, wasn't it? Something that this is brilliant, so good.
I always want to know what is beyond.
I love
Gozer. Entrance.
I love Gozer. I love that costume. It's terrifying. And I like that. I like the fact that the form of the most powerful thing in the evil thing in the universe
wants to be a woman.
Yeah,
you know, it chose to be a woman.
That's kind of different for the day, you know. I think
it is. Yeah. Because you got, as you're saying, you only got like three key characters in the film that are women. You've got Dana, Janine, and then Goza.
And then it's an androgynous form as well.
Yeah. Good evening. So I love this moment because he actually gives a really good speech, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And then because he's not a god, he's a threat, you know.
You say this links up earlier with the scene in the library.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, because now Veitman's in charge. Yeah. He knows how to dictate.
Yeah, and he will delegate.
Well. Yeah.
Yeah. It is teaching business skills, basic business skills, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. But also, because when they get attacked.
Management skills.
And Winston's like, you know, next time someone asks you if you're a guard, you say, yes! And then Ray's like, so, he's like a child who's done something really bad. You know, the look on his face.
That's a great surreal image too, isn't it?
Yeah, because the people below have no idea what's going on. And just seeing all this lightning and flashing stuff, it's just, terrifying stuff.
Such a good line.
It's like he's been told off by his dad, you know.
No, but the absurdity of it. If somebody tells you you're a god, you say yes. It's so... That, I mean, again, the absurdity, the kind of the surrealness of it.
I always love it because Ray always has the most gear on. You know, he's always got extra stuff around his belt and stuff. He just drops off the trap, doesn't need it.
I mean, this is quite a mean-spirited film in many ways, and yet it has so much heart. I don't know how it does it. It's just amazing. It's an incredible piece of work.
That's what I think made people... I think a lot of people made doubt about the kind of remake, of the worries that come in, because... So much of this is, you know, we're talking about the tone, you know, all different elements thrown into it. It's very difficult to replicate.
Yeah. I was going to say, I absolutely love her costume, by the
way. She's posing as well, not even looking at them.
I love her costume, though.
Even a flat top. What a hair.
John Landis is an American Werewolf in London.
Mm-hmm.
I think this film has a lot in common with that. Not just because Elmer Bernstein did the music.
Oh, because of tone.
Yeah, well, the fact that it's a comedy and it's really funny, but it also has really dark ideas. I mean, Werewolf takes it further, I think.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, because it knows its rating. It knows what's going. You know, it knows it's not trying to make a family.
And it's full of blood.
Movie,
you know.
Yeah.
Whereas, this is.
It's got many influences. I think at the time, it's borrowed other things.
Well, of course, also because it's a Saturday night, you know, you've got the Saturday Night Live. I mean, I'm thinking of John Landis. All these people link up. I mean, hold on a minute. Animal House was directed by Landis, and you've got produced by Reitman,
Eddie
written
got,
by Ramis.
Ramis to Caddyshack.
Yeah.
Caddyshack's still one of my favourite comedies. Yeah. But that itself has so many quotable lines, and, you know, it's written, this is co-written by Ramis as well.
But again, it's...
loaded with them.
It's interesting, again, we're saying it's localised. There isn't... You don't see any news reports around the world about what's happening.
At all, yeah.
It is very contained.
Well, Ghostbusters has always been like that, even the cartoon, wasn't it? The cartoon tries to keep everything together. Well, the cartoon does go out of the bounds of New York and does more kind of other places. You know, the Ghostbusters even go on holiday, then they get attacked or whatever.
Hmm. See, this is another thing. I was talking about business again, and the fact...
Choose a form.
Well, choosing the form... The fact that Ray has got no business instinct in him at all whatsoever, he doesn't realize, you know, he doesn't really understand how it is to be anything to be, you know, he's just a complete academic.
Yeah.
And he can't really function as a professional. And both him and Egon rely on Peter all the time,
yeah,
you know, to manage them. And yet
he's so guilty.
Yeah, when he's asked, you know, to think of something off the top of his head, the first thing he thinks of is a corporate branded image.
Yeah, yeah.
The irony of it, you know, is so clever.
What would you choose, though, Tim, as your form of the destructor?
I'd obviously choose Oliver Harper.
I'd do some serious damage, mate.
Look, this is so good, isn't it? But again, as we were saying before, this... You know, we were saying before, outside on the street, you've got the Ghostbusters brand and everyone's cheering and
that's
making
right,
up.
Yeah.
And it's a brand in the film, it's brand outside of the film. This is a fictitious brand of marshmallow that never existed.
Yeah.
And yet everyone gets it. Everyone...
Exactly.
It always gets a laugh.
It's very subtle foreshadowing earlier.
Listen to that music and that sting. Right. And that, you know, the sound, the growl, the roar of him as he appears. Just absolutely amazing.
Because as a kid, whenever they talked about visual effects... before the release of Jurassic Park and T2, this was always shown. Showing you, you know, the power of visual effects and the quality of them.
But even this area here, too. Look, there's no steel and no glass.
You were saying to me, because I was talking to Tim on the phone the other week, and you were saying about how good Ivan Reitman is at these kind of scenes with huge amounts of people.
Yeah, no, I actually haven't mentioned... We barely mentioned anything about his directing style. Well, certainly, as you were saying before, there is, you know, on his previous films, they are quite, they feel sort of almost functionally directed in terms of comedy grammar, in terms of there is coverage of actors and there are wide shots. You know, it's he
dialogue,
does it,
dialogue
it's really skillfully done. But I think in this, he took it the next step because he became a special effects, big Hollywood action movie director too. And I think that a huge standout in the film is the fact that so much of it was shot in, you know, Burbank Studios in LA.
Yeah.
And in California. And then you've got all the stuff in New York. And then you've got locations that are matched with other things. And it all integrates seamlessly. And you really feel when you're on the street with the crowd, with the Ghostbusters, it all feels so legitimate. It all feels real time. It feels live. And he coordinates it so effortlessly. And I guess maybe because he's a producer as well, he knows how to bring out production value.
I think he does. I think he has proven to be a far more successful producer than, say, a director, I think.
But, I mean, this is masterfully directed.
It is, really. You wouldn't know that Ivan Reitman had no experience beforehand with visual effects. And suddenly he's doing this big thing and he's having to manage everything. I think he's a very good manager, I think, really. That's what's kind of played to his skills.
Like Peter Venkman? No, I'm kidding. No, but it's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
That we've actually said, you know.
No, because, you know, if we go back to, like, say, Superman the movie, you wouldn't think Richard Donner could be able to do a film like that, just looking at The Omen, his previous TV work. I don't think you'd think at the time he could do that. Now, you're looking at this, a guy who's done mostly just comedy films, suddenly doing this big visual effects spectacular.
Evolution would have helped, you know, would have been helped by the fact that he'd done
Ghostbusters. Oh, of course, yeah.
But Ghostbusters 2 is even bigger and made on a tiny schedule.
That's what kind of really kind of screwed it up, I think.
But it's still held together amazingly well.
It is.
Those crowd scenes at the end with the museum are incredible.
Really,
but this is just, you know, this is something else. It doesn't feel, there's a sense of place to the whole thing.
Mm.
Well, one of my friends told me that. He said he thinks that this really has a sense of place, and I agree.
It's a great geography to it. You know, you don't feel lost at all.
Even though it is a complete lie.
Oh,
geography.
It really is, and
Spook Central is fabricated.
When you watch Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, it's all over the place with its geography, but you just buy it into it.
Yeah. But never in this film do I feel like I'm watching somebody in a hotel in New York and then they're on a soundstage. But it all feel there is a feeling, you get a vibe of
the great
people
blend
and
of
personality. This is so ludicrous.
Also makes great production design, isn't it, really?
It's amazing. This
boom!
Incredible pyrotechnic there.
Look at that. I always thought the cloud made a face. I also thought it made a little bit like Marshmallow.
It kind of does, doesn't it? Yeah, that's interesting, Oliver. And the punchline to this, of course, is that our guy from the EPA, Peck, is going to get a big mouthful of
marshmallow. Apparently they used half the intended amount because the stuntman went in and got knocked out completely. Look at that, Matt. Beautiful.
But yeah, I mean, this is it. As I say, I don't see... Even though Peck is an antagonist of sorts, he's not Gozer. He's not
really the bad guy because he's gone in with good intentions, and that's his job, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, and
for
that's
the safety of everyone.
But it, I mean, this is it. It's the absurdity of everything, the absurdity of the world we live in, the absurdity of bureaucracy.
Yeah. I love this moment here because everyone else is completely covered in shaving foam, or, you know, well, that's what they actually use, but we're saying marshmallow, but Vakeman's absolutely fine. But I love, this is also another moment here where Ray gives, he uses his nickname for Vakeman. He calls him Vakey. He goes, Vakey! You know.
The other thing that I was going to say as well is, even though Sigourney Weaver, even though she's not been performing anything during this whole sequence, subliminally, you really do believe she's been that dog the whole time.
You do, don't you? Yeah, yeah.
Just things, that's really good direction.
It really kind of sells it when she literally climbs out of this kind of, like, incinerated dog.
Her performance.
Barbecue.
She looks like she has been inside that dog.
Yeah, yeah.
Moving around, possessed.
You could think, oh, she's gone. She's
just that, just that concept of her being inside a gargoyle that's moving around, possessed. Like, it's such an abstract idea.
It's something else you've never seen before as well. I think all the money went on her prosthetic piece because when it cuts to Rick Moranis, he's wearing three pieces. It's just like he's already broken out of it.
Well, I like that they make the most of the comedy with him and they put him in the dog head.
Yeah,
I think that's very.
But I was never happy with the line though when he says "Who turned out the lights?" Whatever. It's like, oh, no.
Oh, it's funny.
It's like seeing someone sipping a banana peel in the film. You think, no, that's an old gag. Don't use that.
Oh, it's good. And that music by that theme for Dana by Elmer Bernstein is
beautiful.
Beautiful.
It's just completely. That's why I drove me nuts about the score for number two was the score for her theme. It's like someone's composed it on a Casio keyboard. This is just a beautiful orchestral piece.
It does elevate it somewhat, doesn't
it? Yeah, it does. Yeah, gives it some extra level of class. You know, production value.
I like the fact that Lewis makes a networking opportunity out of this, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah.
He says, who does your taxes?
Exactly.
Again, business.
Yeah. But he's still doing the taxes in the second one, isn't he?
He's a lawyer, isn't he?
Yeah, yeah. He's got his degree at night school, doesn't he?
Yeah.
It's great. But also, he's completely... He's not even listening to what they're saying because he goes, we want to test some of your brain.
But this is like... He could have been killed in all of this. And the first thing he's thinking about is networking. It's getting back on the... way. He never learns, you know. I actually think at this point... love this line.
He's great, isn't it?
But that has so much meaning of its own, I think. I think that's a genuinely pure sort of morale feeling, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I mean...
the chaos in New York, they still love it.
And the branding, the branding peaks here.
Yeah.
But also...
You've got people have got the T-shirts now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
T-shirts weren't there earlier.
But that said, realistically, this is the end of the Ghostbusters. They're out of business now. They've defeated that god.
Yeah.
The ghosts have, you know, were long gone. They only came because of the god.
But also, that plays into number two.
They're a red herring. They're actually a red herring in a film called Ghostbusters. They're the red herring. You know.
But that was never... Because they never intended it to be a sequel, so they'd written it in a way for it to end.
But I think Venkman finds... He finds love... You know, he's found someone he really likes, and it doesn't matter about keeping up with the Joneses and, you know, and joining the rat race and being on top. But he doesn't. You found someone, you found love, and that I think that's kind of the there's a love message there.
But also, the way the film ends is like the way where the credits are rolling with the actors. You see the character with the actor's name as well. doesn't happen that often in movies anymore, does it? Do you think it's, a, is it something they do on TV
that's
or
almost,
comedy?
Yeah, that is a sitcom kind of device, isn't it? Yeah. It's almost like you have been watching Ernie Hudson. And da, 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 da,
da, da, da. I love all that. It is. That's what they also did in like Predator. I love all that yeah. kind of sequence.
Well, more so in a comedy. You see it more in a comedy.
You do, yeah.
But the fact they've got it with this, you know, with this music playing over the top. I like the doorman has got marshmallow on him. You see they're blessing the marshmallow.
Is he related to Michael Caine?
I have no idea.
Sheldon Caine. There's one called Michael Caine as well, works with Spielberg.
So uplifting, isn't it? Makes you want to punch the air. So good.
It's a great feel-good movie. I love it.
But I think it actually has weight to it. I hear friends, you know. Look at this guy. What's he singing? You know, when people chanting.
No music was there.
But in your mind, you're thinking they're singing the Ghostbusters theme,
yeah,
surely.
Yeah.
And it hadn't even performed at that point, you know. No, I absolutely. If it isn't obvious already,
do you think because you were saying when we in preparation for this commentary, they recycled the Slimer visual effect.
Oh yeah, attacks, this shot of him at the end,
he attacks Vagman.
This little cliffhangery thing of
because it's kind of hinting. It kind of stutters a little bit as it gets close. Well, as it gets from the distance,
it's from the same angle as when he sees Peter in the corridor.
That's right. Yeah,
but I think the film does have. You know, I think. You know, I've got a lot of friends who just kind of, they dismiss it and they say, oh, it's just some puerile 80s comedy.
That's right. I mean,
it's
yeah,
sexist.
Just...
And, you know, and I think there are, you know, there are period elements of it that are, you know, unfortunate in a way. But I think the film has a lot going on.
Do you think the film has kind of stuck with you because it was part of your childhood? I mean, if you looked at it now as an adult, would it have the same effect?
It's so interesting you say that because I always thought it was... a horror as a kid. I didn't think that it was a comedy.
Yeah, yeah, my opinion has changed on it. Yeah.
It looked, I never knew. I was never in on the joke that it was
no
comedy.
Because I loved all the visual effects and stuff and seeing them ghostbusting and the horror aspects because you've only kind of come through that as a kid through the real Ghostbusters.
And even in the cartoon, yeah, the real Ghostbusters, it always had something bigger to it. I guess maybe...
But then I watched the cartoon as an adult. There is a lot of gags in it, very much like the film.
But you really focus... I mean... Even the poster for it is dark and, you know...
Yeah, yeah.
It's hard to put your finger on, but I always thought it was a much darker movie.
Mm.
So when now I appreciate it on different levels, and of course the rich cinema heritage of the Saturday Night Live performers and Ivan Reitman and all these great people.
Yeah.
It makes it, and Boss Films, amazing visual effects, and the great cast, Sigourney Weaver, you know... It makes it into something else, but I certainly have always seen it as a horror. So I'm really, I appreciate it very much. So now.
I appreciate it more now as for its comedy aspects, I think, and just the kind of atmosphere to it. Yeah, it's just the way it looks and stuff. It just kind of resonates with me. And it's one of those movies I can just watch over and over again, and it's one of my favourite movies.
It has a token amount of horror in it, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah, I think it's kind of nicely balanced out. And I think it kind of may have a little bit more comedy than, say, the horror, because obviously comedy is obviously subjective, so whatever you find funny, I might not. But I think there's always kind of a little bit more extra bits of comedy when you kind of revisit the movie. Because I've rewatched this movie so many times. And when I kind of, you know, we did review it a couple of years ago, my retrospective, and kind of, you know, gauging people's opinions when they kind of write feedback or discuss the movie themselves. Some people think the film's just kind of average to them and it didn't really kind of stick with them.
Mm.
But the majority, I mean, 8 out of 10, you know, most people absolutely adore the movie.
It's a very cynical film.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
I think it's very clever. And it fits in with all of those, you know, films, you know, we mentioned before about Trading Places.
Yeah, yeah, it fits right within that.
But it's not as broad as...
style of comedy.
It's not as broad as something like The Blues Brothers.
No, it's not, no.
Yeah.
But it's just, you know, one of those movies that's from the 80s that's kind of, it's kind of aged very well. I mean, it's obviously the odd wobbly visual effect with the stop motion, but
yeah, but who
from
cares?
That,
you
don't care because you just kind of look past that.
The sense of imagination. There's just, I mean, I get great joy just looking at these end credits as well.
Yeah, yeah.
This kind of overture of songs that meld into each other.
Sure, sure.
It must be magical to be part of
it. It must
have
been so difficult for them at the time to sort of really kind of top this film with Ghostbusters 2. And it was never a film that was never going to be on par with this. It's such a challenge to beat this movie.
Well, this on paper just shouldn't have worked at all.
Oh, yeah, yeah. As I was saying earlier, you know, trying to pitch the idea to Columbia. So if it was all written down in detail, I don't think they would have even commissioned it.
So the idea of trying to get lightning in a bottle twice.
Yeah. So difficult. So difficult.
But it is such a dark film. It really is such a really dark movie, and it's got such mass appeal, and it's fun and light, but it's really like,
well, it's because the dark element's going to play in, yeah, in these scary moments for an adult movie, and kids can enjoy it for its kind of visuals and kind of the ghosts and stuff, but there's so much more to it than being a sort of family
movie.
It's an adult film that's kind of given. It's played it down a little bit to be a PG.
Thanks, Oliver.
Well, everyone, hope you enjoyed the commentary. Me and Tim will be back with another one, which will be Super Mario Brothers the movie. Okay, everyone, take care and goodbye.